use a blackboard which is behind me. So I marked a region which I know is visible. I will use that. So the I'm kind of interested in some kind of existence problems and counting problems in discrete math. So I'm going to discuss one style of problems that fascinates me. And I did some work in parts of it. So we are looking at problems of this kind. So we have a set N, which is all numbers, say 1 to N, all integers. And we're looking at subsets of it. So all possible subsets is just 2 power N, and that is not very interesting. What we want to look at is a subset which satisfies certain properties. Like, what are the kind of properties we like to look at? One example, and so this is sorry to presentation mode. So one kind of properties would be like say any two of them should have a non-empty intersection. This is the famous Edwards-Corrado kind of results and so on. So they try to construct sets. What's the largest family you can have, which will have such properties and so on. But here we're looking at somewhat different criteria. What we want to look for is kind of existence questions. Like one of the simplest one is the degree sequence problem. So for a degree sequence for a simple graph, means we will be given some numbers like d1, d2 up to dn, which are positive integers, and we want to find a graph where the degrees will correspond to d1 to dn. So let's look at an example. Like typically a graph is given or drawn in R2 like this. Like there are 5 points, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in our initial setup, n is 5, and then we have some subsets of it. So here subsets are size 2, which you usually draw with a straight line, like 1, 2, 2 here is an edge. So what we get is something like this. Like our set is 1 to n, all the numbers from 1 to n, and then the family is some subsets of size 2, like 1, 2, because there is an edge 1, 2, then we have 2, 3, then we have 2, 5, then we have 2, 4, then we have 3, 4, and then we have 4, 5. So these are all the subsets that we have in this, and this is a subset of all possible subsets of size 2. We are not including everything, like the subset 1, 3 is not there. And what we mean by degrees of here, like D1 is number of edges contain the vertex labeled 1. So here this vertex 1 is only there in one of the sets, 1, 2. We say that it's there in the edge 1, 2. So it has degree 1. Similarly, the vertex 2 is there in 4 of the sets. Is there in the first one, is there in the second one, is there in the third one, and is also there in the fourth one. So we say that this point 2 has degree 4, which you have written here. Similarly, this vertex 3 has a degree 2 over here, and it's in 2 of them, like over here. 2, 3, and then in 3, 4. So this is how we get it. So what we want to ask is the converse of this. Like we are giving you some numbers d1 to dn, and we ask that does there exist a graph such that every vertex I has degree exactly dn. So this one obvious question, one can see that what are the conditions we can put. Suppose there are only n vertices, no degree can be greater than n. In particular, no degree can be equal to n because we are looking for simple graphs. We are not allowing edges to repeat and so on. So each set appears only once. So we can say that one criteria would be that each of these degree di's is going to be lesser equal to n minus 1. And clearly they have to be greater equal to 0. But is it sufficient? So again, by very simple inspection, we can come up with some conditions. It says that sum of all the degrees have to be even. So is that sufficient? Then again realize no. Like if what happens is some degrees are very high and some degrees are very low. Like for example, if one vertex has say degree n minus 1 and another one has degree 0, then it is not possible because the vertex which has degree n minus 1 must connect to every other vertex. and the vertex with degree zero cannot connect with any. So you have contradiction. So one can try to solve this problem by some very simple greedy or local approach. So one of the first ones was done by Havel and Hakimi, and the algorithm was very simple. It says that you arrange the degrees d1, d2 in non-increasing order. That means make it decreasing. Like d1 should be greater or equal to d2, then d2 has to be greater or equal to d3, and so on, all the way up to dn. So we arrange it in non-increasing order. And then we ask the question that, is this graphic? So if I can draw a graph, this vertex with the highest degree has to be connected to some other vertices, and the vertex one has to be connected to how many? Exactly d1 of other vertices. So which ones should we choose? So a good idea would be to choose the ones which have the highest degrees. Don't try to choose the ones which have the smallest degrees. That's a intuitive greedy idea. And what one can then guess is that let's try to remove this vertex d1 and let's reduce the degrees of the next d1 of them, like over here. That means I'm connecting the vertex d1 to the vertex 2, vertex 3, up to how many? Up to d1 of them. And which ones have we chosen? We have chosen the ones which have the highest degrees. And Havel and Hakimi showed that this is graphic if and only if this new sequence is graphic. So that was the result, and it's not very hard to show, and it's a typical undergraduate level exercise. So let's try to see how an example how this method works. So somehow it doesn't allow the display mode in this. So like for example, we take n equal to 6. So there are like vertex 1 has degree 2, vertex 2 has degree 2, and so on. So this is very easy to see that this is graphic. Like we can take two triangles and it will satisfy this. Or you take a cycle, just connect vertex 1 to vertex 2, vertex 2 to vertex 3, vertex 3 to vertex 4, and so on, and then vertex 6 to vertex 1. And you can see that it's going to have a degree sequence, and there are more than one. So if you follow this algorithm, it says arrange them, it's already arranged. And we take this vertex 1, we remove it, and we remove minus 1 from the next two, like from vertex 2 and vertex number 3. And this is the new sequence we get. So if this is graphic, the first one is also graphic. And once we get this sequence, it's no longer in non-increasing order. So what we have to do, we have to rearrange it. And once we rearrange, we get it 2, 2, 2, and then we have 2 ones. So then again, we can use the same sequence, like remove this vertex 1, which has degree 2, and then remove 1 from the next 2. So we'll get the sequence 1, 1, 1, 1. And then again, it's already arranged. So we remove this first one, and then just remove only 1 from the vertex, the second vertex over here. And we continue this process. So in the end, we end with 0, 0. So 0, 0 is graphic, just have two vertices and don't connect anything. So this says that original sequence is graphic. And this gives a very simple algorithm to check if a degree sequence is graphic or not. And this was one of the ways to look at it. And another criteria was given by Ertosh and Galay. So what they showed is that, so let me make this small. So can you see the board? Can anyone see the board now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, so I can just reach the board. So what we want to do is this Ertosh-Galay. This is the Ertosh-Galay condition. So what we do, we keep some vertices 1 to j. And here from j plus 1 to n. And once we make such a partition, then we ask, okay, what's the sum of all possible degrees on the left hand side? So that's going to be sum of all the degrees d1 up to dj. But then we have to see how many edges can we have inside them. There are j vertices. So we can have choose two edges between them. So if I count the degrees between them, I'm going to get j into j minus 1. So this is what we are going to have. So number of edges inside is j choose 2 which the edges which you have put at inside. And so if I count the details which are completely, which can stay inside, it's going to be k times k minus 1. So from the left hand side, the number of edges that has to go out, how much should that be? That has to be the summation of all the degrees on the right hand side. So if so this difference, this is the number of edges that has to go out. The summation of dk for k equal to 1 to j, and then from this you subtract j times j minus 1. This is the number of edges that has to leave the left side, because I cannot connect any more inside. But from the right side, what's the maximum number of edges that can come to the left side? That is dk for each of the vertices, but some of those degrees can be more than j. So this creates a problem, because there are not more than j vertices on the left side. So we have to choose this minimum of j and dk. So whatever the minimum, I have to choose that. Either choose j, or you choose the degree of that vertex, whatever is smaller. So this is the maximum number of edges that can come this side, is the maximum number of edges that can come from the right side to the left side. And this quantity, this quantity is the minus this quantity, the first term on the right, on the inequality side. The difference between them is a minimum number of edges that has to come up. So a clear necessary condition would be that the sum of degrees has to be less or equal to j times j minus 1, and then this plus whatever contribution can come from the right hand side. So this one is the maximum contribution from the right hand side. So this is one of the clear conditions we need, and earlier we observed that sum of degrees should be even. Is same as that problem. Then if you count the number of people who shook their hands and count with the multiplicities, like if someone shook their hands 10 times, count as 10 and so on. So then that number has to be even, and this we can get by a simple double count. So this gives a very neat criteria to check if a degree sequence corresponds to a graph or not. And here the only problem is that the two extra things that I said. One says that sum of degrees has to be even, which we cannot avoid. The other was the use of the minimum thing here. So can we drop this minimum? Yes, answer is yes, and that can be written by this new system of inequalities. So here the number of inequalities was, we have to do it for each j equal to 1 to n. So there was only n of them. So here we need to use quadratic many inequalities. If we are allowed to use that, so then we can get rid of this minimum, and they are essentially the same. It's not really hard to check. You can do a short, you can do a little check to see that this is indeed the case. And so people were kind of happy that we had two different criteria. One, we had a criteria with a very simple algorithm by Hubble and Hakimi, and another by some kind of linear inequalities, which was first given by Erdős and Galay. So the argument I gave over here to justify this, to show that this is necessary, I did not show it is sufficient. And in the previous one, this Hubble-Hakimi algorithm, it shows that, okay, if this works, we get it. It shows that one way kind of is clear, that if this process stops, it's graphic. But can you show that if it doesn't stop, it is not graphic? One can join the two criteria and prove each other. Like, you show that if the Hubble-Hakimi algorithm at some point stops, you can find one of the inequalities of the Erdős-Galay that is violated. And similarly, you can show that if Erdős-Galay inequalities are given to you, the Hubble-Hakimi algorithm will always work. So it's a kind of, you can use one to prove the other, and it's a very neat exercise. So now, since you already have a linear kind of description for this conditions, that when a given degree sequence is graphic or not, one can consider the polytope version of it. So what do we mean? We want to look at all possible degree sequences, look at them, and then look at the convex hull. So this is a polytope which we call the convex hull of degree sequences. Why? Because we have finitely many points and we are taking their convex hull. So what we are going to get is a polytope. So this polytope is kind of interesting. Like when we have a polytope, what are the first things we want to know? Like what are the corners or the vertices or the extreme points of that polytope? So extreme points of this polytope are kind of very interesting. And the other thing we want to know is that what are the inequalities version of it? So given a polytope, it has two equivalent ways to describe it. One as a convex hull of some points, and the other one is going to be as an intersection of half planes. So one way is we defined it as convex hull of all degree sequences. So now we want to look at the other side, is that how do we get it as an intersection of half planes? So this is what we are going to get it as an intersection of half planes. So now we are going to see that how do we get this idea. Okay, so I'm doing it. So what we do is that, can you see the board?
Ah, yes.
Is the board visible? Okay.
Yes. So you have to pin your screen. Yeah.
So what we have partitioned the set N into three parts. One is the set S, one is the set T, and the remaining vertices. Remaining vertices is going to be N minus S minus T. So what we say, that degree of each vertex now we allow it to be a real number which lies between 0 and 1, and then we say that all edges from T are connected to S. Let's make that setup. So then, how we are getting this? We are saying we have broken it, the set N, into three parts, S, T and the remaining. And then we are saying every vertex in T is connected only to S and nowhere else. So that means let's look at the number of edges that it can contribute. So maximum it can contribute which is coming to S is sum of its own degrees. So this is the part. So this is the part that it can contribute. For each of the vertices in T, take the sum xi. So these are the total contribution of the degrees of the vertices in T which is coming inside S. And what should go out of S to get that? Let us check. So we should get summation of xi is the total sum of degrees of the vertices in S. So now each of these vertices can be connected to any of the remaining vertices, that is, what are the remaining vertices for each of them? They can be connected to all the vertices other than T. So other than T, how many vertices are there? Other than T is N minus T, and it cannot connect to itself. So we have this minus 1. So each vertex in S can connect to N minus 1 minus size of T of the other vertices. And there are S vertices in the set S. So we must have this as a condition. So this says that why this condition is necessary. But what Cohen showed that this is also sufficient. So but let's just try to understand that why this is actually the polytope. So here the only condition we need is that S and T, their union should not be empty, and S intersection T should be empty. So this is the only criteria we need. We need a disjoint set S and T such that the union is non-empty, and then this is the natural condition we have. If something has to be graphic, and then look at the convex hull, we should clearly have look at contribution of every vertex in S, that is going to be summation xi for all vertices in S, and we are assuming that everything in T is coming to S, so that contribution will take away. So now we have to satisfy what's the number that has to go out of S? You have to do that. So now every vertex in S has to be, can be connected to N minus 1. This is, it can be connected itself minus all the vertices which are in T, and it can, and this is the maximum number it can connect to, and that gives us this clear upper bound. So this is clearly necessary. And from this definition, not even clear, yes?
So xi's are degrees,
right? Pardon?
Xi's are degrees?
So now they are real numbers because we are looking at the convex hull of degree sequences. So xi's are real numbers which lie between 0 and which are real. So which is from 0 to n minus 1 or something like that. So they are real numbers now.
On the board it's written xi's are between 0 and 1. Oh,
so each xi is a degree, so they are just greater or equal to 0.
So you are relaxing them to be real.
Yeah, I am relaxing the condition, allowing them to be real numbers.
Okay, thank you.
I wrote 1 there. It should be just greater or equal to 0. Okay, so basically xi is a real numbers. So now what we observe is that suppose we set S to be just single vertex I and T to be empty, we are going to get that each xi has to be lesser or equal to n minus 1. So this was our initial observation also, that no vertex can have a degree more than n minus 1. And then similarly, if you set this S to be empty and T to be a single vertex, it gives xi greater or equal to 0. So you see that I don't need to mention the range of each xi. So, because this itself contains that information, that each xi is greater or equal to 0. So, all I should say there is that each xi is just real. And rest of the things will follow from here. And one can actually show that this implies Eddorf-Gallai inequalities because we derived it from there. So, this is indeed a polytope. This shows that it is bounded and is the intersection of half planes clearly, that each of them is a half plane. So, this is a polytope. So next, one can ask, what are the extreme points? It turns out the answer is actually very simple, what the extreme points are. Okay, so the extreme points are some graphs which are like this, the first example I drew. So if we draw that graph as a, just draw the degree sequence in non-increasing order, and then you start running the Hubbell-Hakimi algorithm, you will see that you will never need to rearrange. So that's a kind of special thing. The fact that you don't need to rearrange also implies that there's a unique graph for this. So if I give you this degree sequence, no matter what graph you try to draw with this degree sequence, it will look exactly like this. So these kind of these special graphs are going to be the extreme points. And what about the Eddorf-Gallai inequalities? Again, over there you will see that it turns out in some extremal manner they come in. So that's why these are called threshold graphs, and they were first studied by Schwarthol and Hammer in a very different context. They found out that finding the largest independent set or finding the largest clique in a graph is very hard. But for these class of graphs, you can find very easy. So that's why they found it very interesting, and they thought that this was a threshold property, and they gave the name threshold. But we are going to see a different reason why we can call it threshold. So first is that Hubbell-Hakimi algorithm doesn't need to rearrange for if you start with this sequence. And these threshold graphs can also be constructed in a slightly different way. So what you do, you just draw the five vertices initially, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this vertex 5, and then you make a call that you can build this graph incrementally such that at every stage you either connect to all the vertices or you don't connect to any. So this graph you can build that way. Like for example, we started with the vertex 5, it's a singleton, you do nothing. Then you added the vertex 3 and you did not connect it to the vertex 5. So already you have one vertex 5, you have the choice either to connect with it or you don't. So you have two choices and you choose not to connect. So then you add the vertex 4, you have two choices. Either you connect with both vertices 3 and 5 or you do not connect with either of them. So you cannot say connect only to 3 and not to 5, no. Either you connect to both of them or none. and then the next vertex you add is the vertex 1. So you can choose not to connect with any. So here that has been chosen. And then you add the vertex 2. Here again you have the choice, connect with all or connect with none. So here I choose the option to connect with all of them. So it means that I can order the vertices in such a way that I can build the graph by following just a simple rule. I connect with all the existing vertices or I don't. So this is another way to construct the threshold graphs, and this already says that if I don't allow relabeling kind of, it means there are going to be exactly 2 power n minus 1 of such graph. So if you look at, don't give a label to them and just look at the graphs, because every vertex gets assigned either to all or none, so we have two choices. And when we start, we don't have any choice. So we have total n minus 1 stages where we have a choice, and each time we have exactly 2 choices. So the answer we get is 2 power n minus 1. And they also have another way to describe them. That's is an easier way for us to see the why is this threshold. We can give some real weights to all the vertices like 1, 2, n, such that if something is an edge, then the sum of the weights of those vertices is strictly greater than 0. And if something not an edge, and if something is not an edge, then the sum of those weights is strictly lesser than 0. So this very clearly defines what is an edge and what is not an edge. So if I plot these points in some space, I can draw a hyperplane where all the edges will lie on one side and all the non-edges will lie on another side. So this is a kind of threshold phenomena one can see. And all these definitions are equivalent, not requiring to rearrange in the Hubble-Hakim algorithm, then this first one, and also this one, one can show all of them to be equivalent. In particular, there's a book by Pellet and Mahadev, and they've showed that there are more than 9 different criteria for threshold graphs, and all of them are quite interesting, and they can reduce from one to another. So in our example, like, we should be able to give weights such that the edges are positive and the non-edges are negative. One example of the weights is this one. One can check that this is correct. I hope so, at least. So like here we have this edge because sum of these two numbers is positive, like plus 1. This is an edge because 5 and minus 2 add up to greater than 0. But these two are not connected because sum will be negative. Similarly, these two are not connected because it's going to be negative. And this vertex connected everything because 5 plus any of these numbers is going to be positive. So this shows that this graph is indeed threshold. So then one can ask how many threshold graphs are there. If we don't have labels, we clearly saw the answer is going to be 2 power n minus 1 using one of the criteria. So, but if you allow labels, then how are you going to do it? So you have to observe some very simple properties. The empty graph is clearly threshold. That means you have just vertices and it doesn't have any edges. Or just the empty graph, we say by definition it is a threshold. So the next you observe is the complement of a threshold graph is threshold. So this is actually very easy to see in both of the criteria we saw. Like in this one, you say that it's complement. So at every stage when we're adding a vertex, whatever we did, like over here, we added 3 without joining an edge. So now in the complement, we're going to join the edge. So we're going to reverse each of the steps. So it's clearly going to be, again, threshold. And in this criteria, what we do, we just change the sign of the weights. So then again, it's going to be threshold. So if all non-edge now will become an edge, and all edge will become non-edge. So it's easy to see that for a threshold graph, this complement is also threshold. And then suppose you have a threshold graph and add just a there's a problem, there's a typo here. So if you take a threshold graph and add just a single vertex, so what we do is this. So if you take a threshold graph and then just a vertex and don't add any edge, just add a singleton vertex, isolated vertex, it still continues to be threshold. Because I have not connected any edge to it, I can give some big negative weight to that vertex and that will be a threshold graph. And they are enough to characterize a threshold graph. And we can use this characterization to count the number of labeled threshold graphs. So this was first done by Pellet and Bessinger. So let's look in the way how one can count them. So let Tn be the number of threshold graphs and Sn be the number of threshold graphs without isolated vertices. So in this step 3, so over here we can take a threshold graph and add isolated vertex, it continues to be threshold. So there will be threshold graphs, many threshold graphs which will have isolated vertices. So we are looking for threshold graphs which do not have any isolated vertex, and Tn counts all threshold graphs. And we want to find this number Tn. So this Tn is not going to have a very simple form. Like for T0 is going to be 1. So S0 also we are going to say, S of 0 is also going to be 1. But S of 1 we are going to say 0. So this is a kind of little technical, we want to say why it is 0. Because one vertex we consider it as an isolated vertex. And the remaining whatever number we get there. So these are just the initial values we set. And similarly we can find all T's and T1, T2 like that and S. But we want a nice answer kind of. So nice answer here does not mean we have an explicit answer which gives like say n choose k, like we have a different kind of answers. So what we can do, we can first observe that if you look at the exponential generating function for this t of x, that's going to be e power x s of x. So how are we going to do it? So take the vertices n, break it in two parts. In one part you consider a threshold graph which doesn't have any isolated vertex. In the other part, you don't add any, keep it isolated. Then by this product rule for exponential generating functions, you can find that the generating function is going to be T of x is going to be e power x s of x. And from here, we cannot find either of them because I don't know sx and I also don't know tx. So then we observe that, okay, let's look at all the threshold graph on n vertices. I can break it into two parts. One is going to be all threshold graphs without an isolated vertex, and the other ones are going to be threshold graphs which do not have any isolated vertex. So we are going to break it into two parts. So and so the second part is complement of this is going to be threshold graphs without isolated vertex. So that's again going to be S of n. So we are going to get this T of n equal to 2 times S of n for all n greater or equal to 2. And then by just writing down the exponential generating function, we can say that T of x is 2 times S of x, and this quantity comes because earlier we defined slightly differently this initial condition. So from the initial conditions we are getting this slightly technical thing, and from this we can solve for T of x as this, and once we know T of x we also know what S of x is. So what's the advantage of this? Any property I want to find about these threshold graphs, I can find from this. So this is the exponential generating function for T of x. And exponential generating function means, suppose I have a sequence a0, a1 like that. I'm looking at this sequence summation ai x power n by n factorial. So that's the exponential generating function we are looking for. This is not the ordinary generating function. So this is the exponential one. So I'll just write what I mean by that. So this is what we mean by the exponential generating function, and people use exponential generating functions because you can use this kind of identities very easily and you know exactly what they mean. So the composition formula one can use the product formula very efficiently. For ordinary generating function this thing we cannot use. So that's why I like to use the exponential generating function for counting. So up to this people could do, and this was a very routine and straightforward. And then the problem came, you want to count the number of degree sequences. Like once we know to check if something exists or not, next thing you want to do is to count them. So how can we count them? And before doing that, we can also look at another simple thing, that the moment we have this kind of definition for a threshold graph and we can count them, So then we can look at the hyperplane arrangements. So look at in Rn, look at xi plus xj equal to 0. Look at all these hyperplanes where xi plus xj equal to 0. So there will be about n choose 2 number of them. They are going to divide Rn into different regions. So every region will correspond to a threshold graph. What it means is that so look at all the connected components of Rn minus this list of hyperplanes, remove all of them, and in each connected component, no matter what point you choose, they will give you some weights. If I give those weights to the vertices, I will get the same threshold graph corresponding to those weights. So what it allows us to count the number of regions in this hyperplane arrangement. And hyperplane arrangements and counting number of regions in it and studying the Porser structure over there is one of the central problems in NMRD combinatorics and this kind of geometry and combinatorics intersection. So though it's a very, very discrete problem, it immediately leads to all these interesting connections with the hyperplane arrangements and counting regions. So why we're looking at this is going to be clear a little later. But for degree sequences, we are very good in counting all the extreme points because they are threshold graphs. But when it comes to degree sequences, how do we count them? And this was a difficult problem, which Stanley first did it. And how did Stanley do it? So first thing to observe is that if you take a point which is in the degree sequence polytope, and look for an integer point, and then if all these AIs add up to some even number, then we know it corresponds to a degree sequence of a graph. Why? Because Edrashkala inequalities tells us that. But if you count all the integer points of DA of SN, they are not all graphic sequences. Why? Because it will have some integer points which add up to an odd number. So those are clearly not possible. It also looks that you cannot count all the integer points in DESFN. Though there are a lot of theories, none of them can even give remotely an answer for that. So what Stanley did, he said, okay, I find this counting difficult. I will add one extra coordinate. Look at all the points x1 to xn and add one extra coordinate, which is sum of all the previous one divided by 2. So what does this do? It adds the dimension by 1, which makes certain things a little simpler. More importantly, so an integer point here corresponds to a degree a graphic sequence. So it just corresponds to that of a graph. So now if I can count all the integer points in this new collection of points which we got, then we are done. And one can see that if you add this extra coordinate in this way, it is still a polytope. We just increase the dimension by a bit, and all the integer points now corresponds to degree sequences. But still, how do we count it? And the way to count it is that Stanley realized that this is actually a zonotope. What we mean by a zonotope? We mean that we can write it as a sum of line segments. Okay, so this is an example. Like we take the interval 0, 1 and the interval 1, 2. What is the sum of these line segments? It means take a point here, add, and you will get. So that will give us the interval 1, 3. So this is in just one dimension and is not so interesting. So let's take in two dimensions. So we take the line segment along the y-axis, start at the origin and take one step up. And take this line segment, it starts at the origin and goes along the x-axis, is 1, 0. So if we add a point here and a point here, we are going to get the square 0, 1 cross 0, 1. So by adding line segments, our dimensions can go up. So this is in two dimensions. In n dimensions, you can get a lot more interesting things. So when you can break up a convex polytope as a sum of line segments, one can find the integer points in it quite easily. And the answer is not an explicit number. One can get the exponential JD function for it. And I'm not writing the number because it's very ugly, but since I can share the entire screen, let me just show what the answer looks like. So this was the original paper of Stanley, and these ugly things you look, this was the answer. And once you know the theory of zone ropes and so on, you can see that each of these terms have a very nice meaning. So it's not that bad. But when you try to find the answer from expressions like this, it has a lot of plus minus signs and so on, like inclusion exclusion. You have some plus signs, some minus signs and so on. So a big open problem which Stanley says, can you find a simpler formula? Like that expression which Stanley found is a huge summation, and you can understand what each term means. But together to analyze, even to find asymptotically how big those numbers are, it's quite hard. It took us a lot of work. So a big problem and in enumerated combinatorics is to find a simpler formula for that. Which you just say only plus signs. You should not have a lot of plus sign, minus sign like that. So it should not be a C formula. It's just only additive. And it's not at all clear that one can do that. And over here, when we look at these degree sequences, another thing we observe is that we allowed all possible rearrangements of a degree sequence. Like if I take a graph and just relabel the vertices, I will get maybe a different degree sequence. So I'm counting maybe the same graph many, many times, or the same degree sequence many, many times. They're just different by arrangement. Can we remove that? So that means we should look at the set of all degree partitions of simple graphs and then try to count them. So directly we can't count because it's a difficult problem. So we want to convert it to again the same problem to take the convex sum. So suppose we now take the convex sum of all degree partitions, and let's call it say dp of n. What are the going to be the inequalities of it? It turns out that earlier the linearized version of the Eder-Schell inequalities, that is a candidate choice for it. You want to say that each coordinate is greater or equal than the previous one, and then you have this necessary conditions which we had earlier, just put them. So what's the advantage? If you compare with the Cohen polytope, you see that had exponentially many inequalities. Like if you go here, you see over here we had exponentially many inequalities. This was for all partitions of n in some sense. Like you have to choose and set s and set t, and then you have this huge collection of inequalities. So that's very large. Can we make it smaller? That's the aim. So what this does is that it's going to make it look quadratic. So that's a big gain. So now we are looking at a much smaller polytope. So this is just quadratic many inequalities. But are they same? So it's not clear that they are same. So what we're asking, if you look at the convex hull of all the degree partitions, and then you look at all the system of inequalities, are they going to be the same? And second thing, if you look at this in system inequalities, what are their extreme points going to be? I'm running out of time, so I will just skip several things. It turns out that they are actually same, and the extreme points are the threshold partitions. And threshold partitions we observed earlier was 2 power n minus 1. So one can show that this is indeed very surprising that we have not introduced in some sense any new extreme points. And this is actually very surprising. So why? So suppose you have a integral polytope, that means all the extreme points are integers, and if you consider any permutation, it again lies in the same polytope. Like an example, our degree sequence polytope. You take any point, you look at its rearrangements, that point also lies inside. So if you want to look at the key part or the asymmetric part of it, one can define it as look at x1 greater or equal to x2 like that and all integer points. And another would be, you just add the inequalities x1 greater equal to x2 greater equal to xn. And really these two will be same. Like one example, this is same, is for the hypercube. And another example, non-trivial example we know is this degree sequence. Like for example, we consider this polytope over here, and then we add x1 greater equal to x2 to that condition. So we get this one. But yet, if you look at the convex hull of all the degree partitions, we get a different polytope here. So here what happened, a new extreme point was created, which was not not an integer point. So this is a possibility. But in this case, it does not happen. And the proof was using some very strange kind of ideas, which was not earlier used in this context. And one can show that for degree sequence polytope, it is indeed the same. So now, what's the advantage or what do we gain from it? What we gain from it is that now we can consider since I'm running out of time, so I want to skip some things. So now what we want to do, we want to just count the integer points in the simplified one. So now we got a simplified polytope, which is the asymmetric part of the big one. We roughly know what the answer is going to be. It's going to be roughly 1 by n factorial. But can we count this exactly? And Stanley and others have quoted it as the most important problem in the counting integer point in polytopes. So now we have a new polytope. What is the polytope? Take the convex hull of all degree sequences and then look at only the asymmetric part. And how do we define the asymmetric part? It doesn't matter. We can take any one of the two definitions. So that is very neat. But now can we count the integer points in it? So here comes the difficulty. Now Stanley's trick to add one extra coordinate and then dividing, adding up all the entries, dividing by 2, that does not make a zonotope and we don't know how to count it. So any progress in this would be a important contribution, and we know what the answer is. It's going to be the roughly the volume of BSN or the number of integer points in the degree sequence polytope divided by n factorial. So this is all those things we can do for graphs. So a very natural question arises, what can we do for hypergraphs? So for hypergraphs, let's first start with a simple problem that given a degree sequence, does it correspond to a hypergraph? So for hypergraphs, we are looking at uniform hypergraphs. That means every set or every edge is going to have exactly k vertices in it. So for k equal to 2, it just corresponds to graphs. So when we mean hypergraph, we're looking for k greater or equal to 3. And the simplest case is going to be having constant degrees for all. And this problem itself is not so easy. And the all the known proofs which can be used to solve this problem was uses integrality of network flow in some sense or the other. And Baranai is the first one to solve it. But Baranai was not really looking at this degree sequence for hypergraphs. He was looking at a different problem. So what he was looking for is this. You look at all subsets of size k. You have underlying set n. Look at all subsets of size n. You want to break this collection of all k subsets into some sets si, which are all disjoint. And each si will contain exactly n by k sets of size k. So clearly this means that k should divide n, otherwise Baranai's theorem won't be true. So that's the first requirement we have, that k should divide n. So then we can break it up in this form, and these are all disjoint union. So how can we do that? Let's try to look at the simplest case for graphs. It means you look at the complete graph, I can write it as a union of matchings. I take a graph, say, complete graph on say 4 vertices or say 6 vertices, I can and I want to say that and it should be even number of vertices, say 6. I can write it as a union of perfect matchings, and this can be done as a simple exercise. But for hypergraphs it's not so easy. Like for the case k equal to 3, there was a separate proof which was quite difficult. For k equal to 4 also there was a proof which was even harder. And k equal to 5, only some partial results were known. So it was a big surprise when Baranai came up with a proof which uses network flows, and it gave an explicit construction how to do this. And then people tried to remove the flow idea, but they could not. I mean, whatever proof anyone has come up with till now uses the flow kind of idea and then shows it as integral, integral flow, and which corresponds to these sets. And how does that solve? So what condition does it give? So it gives this condition. I must say that how Barnard's theorem solves this case. Let's consider the case that k divides n, because that's simpler. So what it does, you look at each class Si is going to contain n by k sets, and that means every vertex is going to appear exactly once. So that will add degree 1 to all. If I just take a graph with just one Si, so the degree is going to be all 1s. So if I take two of them, I'm going to get degree sequence all 2s. If I take three of them, I'm going to get degree sequence all 3s. So this is what we are going to get. But what happens if k does not divide n? In that case also you can do. In that case, one can show that the necessary condition you need is the what's written here, that n should divide the LCM of k and n times c. So and it's a modification of that proof. It's not really a difficult proof, but it solves the problem for the constant case. So what if it is not constant? Then till now we don't know of any algorithm that can do it. So what if we try the polytope approach? If you try the polytope approach, we can see that extreme versus Swift threshold, and we get something interesting. So here again I have to say E does not belong to this set E. And what is interesting here, that now suppose you want to count the threshold graphs, our simple JNT function idea and all the scatterization, none of them are there. So the problem is very difficult. So now if you want to count how many extreme points are there, the only way you can do is to use this hyperplane arrangement idea. So that's why in the two case, hyperplane arrangement was not really required to count the number of extreme points. One can do using very simple external JNT functions. But in this case, you have to use the arrangement of hyperplanes, and then you have to look at the intersection poset, and from there you have to get a kind of inclusion exclusion kind of formula which counts the number of extreme points. But still, number of extreme points one can count is manageable. But what about the points inside the polytope? So here we are absolutely clueless, and no one knows how it can be done. Probably it cannot be done. And what if we consider the convexal of degree partition of our hypergraphy sequences? Is it again going to be just extreme threshold graphs at the extreme points? Answer is no. You are going to have some extra points, and they correspond to something called order ideals. It means that I can give an order on the vertices, which will induce an order on the edges. We say that if some edge, say E, appears, then all edges lesser than E also should appear. And it corresponds to them. And then one can ask, do all order ideals correspond to extreme points? That answer is probably no. So all this requires a lot of hard work to prove. And then still we are not making any progress to see that whether we can characterize degree sequence of hypergraphs or not. So then Shmuel Ohm came up with a very simple proof by choosing appropriate problem to show that given a degree sequence, it corresponds to a hypergraph or not is NP-complete. So that shows that why none of the counting ideas or the algorithms to check if a sequence is hypergraph or not is not working. And there are a lot of interesting polytope results and counting results related to it. But none of them address the main problem. And this probably gives an indication why you cannot do it. Because most NP-complete problems do not have a nice counting method. None of the regular counting methods work for NP-complete problems. So it's a kind of explanation why we cannot get a nice counting formula. By nice, I mean even exponential JNT function will be nice. Even that we are unable to get. So this is for hypergraph. But what are the main problems in this area? What are the types you're looking for? We're looking for general design problems which all statisticians are interested in. So what is a TBK lambda design? It means we are looking at subsets of size k, and we want to have some nice regularity property. You said if you look at any subset T of size T, so number of members of F which contain that set T, this capital T, is going to be exactly lambda. So it's a kind of So here what happened, that for hypergraphs degree sequence, we are looking at degrees of a vertex. Like given a vertex I, how many edges contain it? So here you can treat this as F as set of edges. But instead of vertices, we are looking at sets of size T. So vertices are sets of size 1. So here, instead of looking at degrees of what sets of size 1, we are looking at sets of size t. So this is more general. And over here, even the constant case, which is trivial for graphs and which we can do very easily for hypergraphs with Baranis theorem, already it requires some idea. It requires flow ideas to do it. Over here, it looks incredibly hard. And there's a very natural, necessary condition that one can come up with is this one. So I'm running out of time, so I'm not explaining how this comes. It actually comes by, you can check from the slide, one can show it like this. It comes by a very simple double counting argument. And there's a conjecture that this is indeed sufficient. And people were unable to prove even that, and it took more than 20-30 years to show that over here in this collection F, so either we are putting an edge a set in it or not. So we had a 0, 1 values. If we allow integer values over it, that means the set can appear say minus 5 times. What do you mean by minus 5? So it means that that set we are giving the weight minus 5. So when we are adding, instead of adding 1, you put minus 5 there. So that way, this it was shown that this condition is sufficient. And people made a lot of small progress. Like for t equal to 2, this was done by Wilson, and it was considered one of the best results. And based on that, Wilson got a job in Caltech. And very little progress was made. And the only progress was made that it can be done if you give integer weights, not even positive. There was no known proof with even positive weights. So then Peter Kiwash solved this problem using remarkable polynomial method, like and the randomness method, a classical design theory methods. He combined all of them. It's a very long and a very difficult to read paper because it had ideas of multiple areas, and he could show that this is indeed sufficient. So we have managed to know that this necessary condition that we get here is sufficient for T designs. But what about arbitrary numbers? Clearly, they are going to be NP complete. Like instead of saying that each T set appears lambda times, suppose I say this T set appears this many times, that T set appears this many times. Can we solve that? Now, instead of just specifying degrees of sets of size T, suppose I allow two different sizes. Like suppose I give you degrees of set size T1 and also size T2. Can I do them? So those are incredibly hard problems which we understand extremely little about it. And any progress in any of them would be a big achievement. So counting problems in this case is absolutely hopeless because you can't even answer any existence questions nicely. So these are some of the kind of problems that I really like looking at, and some of them I worked on it. And since I'm time, so I like to stop here. And thank you for this opportunity. Though this is not the way I like to give a lecture, but we can't do anything better right now.
Yeah, thank you, Professor. Yeah. Audience, if you have any doubt, you can ask.
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, the question is that, I mean, we have Hubble-Hakimi algorithm to check whether whether an integer sequence is graphic or not.
Yes.
And I'm also aware that there are other also if and only conditions also there. So yes, what is
at least n.
Yeah, I mean, so what is the utility of having so many conditions? I mean, Hubble-Hakimi condition is very easy to understand and also to implement.
Yes, but if you want to count, you want to ask other kind of questions, then you need other criteria.
I mean, can you just give one example?
And for example, like we want to count the number of threshold graphs. And if you use the Hubble-Hakimi criteria, that you never need to rearrange while running the algorithm, that way counting would be very difficult. And
but
that
I mean,
idea, And that idea does not generalize to hypergraphs at all. This is a
hypergraphs. It's not applicable. But I mean, this rearranging is that difficult to do? It's a polynomial time.
No, you have to count. You have to count number of sequences for which you do not need rearranging.
Oh, okay.
So that's what it says. You want to count the number of sequences. By the threshold, a lot of work has been done. There are also people have defined a measure of how non-threshold a graph is and so on. So for all of them, using any fixed definition is not easy. Like when we went to hypergraph, we wanted to say that extreme points are threshold. So the usual definition of threshold graphs do not extend. Only one definition extends, the one with giving weights, because it's more suited for linear algebra kind of situation. That you're putting weights, you want greater than zero, lesser than zero. The other combinatorial ones do not work. But there are other problems for which they are useful. In fact, there's a big book called Threshold Graphs and its related applications. And in matching theory and other places also, it comes in very, very deeply. Like I did not talk about the matching theory connections with it because it requires very specific knowledge. For that reason, I did not do it. But it has a lot of connections with other areas. And for that, Hubble-Hakimi algorithm is the least suitable of all the methods.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, if there is no other question, let us thank Professor Amritova for his interesting talk. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. So, Professor, please send the slides to me. I will circulate to the participants.
I'll just fix the typos in it and then send it to you tomorrow.
Yeah, sure. No problem. Yeah. I will upload.
I just realized there are several typing mistakes. So I'll just fix that and send.
Okay. So I have recorded the talk. I will put it in YouTube.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.